lovelies, welcome back to my channel and welcome to another Vintage Tips and Tricks video. Today I'm going to do the second installment of What Era Is It Anyway? And that is explaining the era of the 1950s and what women wore in this era. Tried to dress appropriately for the era and done a bit of a Sophia Loren look today. I've got my bullet bra on, I've got my wiggle skirt going on, so represent. So without further ado, I'm going to get into the types of outfits that women wore. The thing that I think really epitomized this era was the wasp waist, named because of the shape of the wasp, which is what many designers aimed for. Quite literally, with many of the skirts and outfits, you'll see that they had that very angular kind of pointy bust happening, tiny waist, and then immediately going out into that kind of diamond shape of the hips that was created particularly by the sheath dress and the sheath skirt. They even created pockets that would kind of jut out from the side of the hips to make the hips look larger and the waist look smaller. And then they would wear waist cinches or waspies, hence the name. The waspy and the waist cincher were undergarments that were worn beneath the clothing to cinch your waist in and give you that very, very defined hourglass shape. So with that waspy look came things like clam diggers, petal pushers, and capri pants, which had that same high-waisted element. Many of the pants had a thick waistband built in, the sorts of bands that you will find on pants from Pinup Girl Clothing and Vivian of Holloway, which I think are the two best reproduction brands for this era. If you're wanting to find skirts and pants that really fit this waspy shape, they do a fantastic, very true to the era job. What you may ask is the difference between clam diggers, petal pushers, and capris, because a lot of sources on the internet will tell you that they're the same thing, but actually they are not. Clam diggers are tight fitting, but tight fitting for the 50s meant that they were cut to your body shape, not that they hugged your body like a lot of pinup style clothing does, but they were fitted. Clam diggers came either on the knee or just below the knee. Petal pushers cut off mid-calf, and capris cut off at the ankle. So for example, you often saw the likes of Jane Mansfield and Ava Gardner wearing petal pushers, but someone like Audrey Hepburn was famous for wearing capris, particularly in Funny Girl. They were also referred to as cigarette pants, but cigarette pants were much more closely fitted. Again, a cigarette pant generally cut off around the ankle, so they were kind of like the capri pant, but they were generally a more of a tailored, slimmer fitting pant. And you can find plenty of them all over Etsy. That is the great thing about this era, is it is that little bit closer to us, so it can be easier to find really authentic vintage items from the 1950s because they're literally just still in existence. The other thing that was highly popular during the 1950s that we are all familiar with is the full skirt, particularly the circle skirt. Now here's the thing, people don't realize what it means essentially for a circle skirt, or they think that the circle skirt was like the only kind of skirt that was available in the 50s. Actually, the full skirt had a lot more material than the circle skirt did, and was really common in like evening wear or restaurant length dresses, and that would give you a lot of gathering, and women would have really big petticoats, lots of petticoats, many layers, or sometimes even a hoop underneath. And they were made from quite heavy, thick material to hide the fact that they were wearing undergarments, otherwise they would show through, which tends to be a big issue with a lot of reproduction, circle skirts and full skirts. The material is really thin cotton, and then you can see all of your undergarments through it. I don't mean visually see through the material, I just mean you can see the shape of your undergarments, the wiring, the sewing, etc. That's because originally circle skirts and full skirts were made of much heavier draping material. The circle skirt is exactly what it sounds like. It is a giant circle of material with a hole cut in the middle for your waist. You can do a half circle skirt, which is a half piece of material which is going to make less gathers. But then there's variations on that that aren't actually the circle skirt. So what you may see in a vintage store and think is a circle skirt may actually not be. So for example, the gathered skirt, which is actually a square shape of material that's gathered together around the waist, and because of the fact that the top of it is made from a square and then gathered in to create the waist, it creates kind of a boxy shape around the hips, and again creates that waspy waist, but in a full skirt. You've also got gourd skirts. Now, gourd skirts are still popular today. They're actually created from a series of triangles sewn together, so they have a lot of seams throughout them, and it means that you get fewer gathers or waves throughout the skirt, but the skirt still has a fullness, almost a fluted effect toward the bottom, and you will get those sort of sections. But you can tell because the seams will come out at an angle like this. And of course, tiered skirts, which is several banded layers getting bigger and bigger as they go down, which were kind of famous more in the peasant skirt or Latino skirt look, which also became very popular in the 1950s. You would have seen them in a lot of B-Westerns, some of the movies that Sandra Dee or Doris Day became famous for, and were often paired with a peasant top. Then there is the difference between the different types of incredibly famous wiggle skirts. These were named because they were fitted and were actually quite difficult for women to walk in. So women had to learn to walk crossed. So when they took a step, they crossed their foot one over in front of the other, causing their hips to do this movement and their bum to wiggle. The girl can't have it, she was born to please. Hence it was called the wiggle skirt. But that wasn't actually the name of the individual skirts. It represented several types of tight fitting skirts. The first one being the pencil skirt. The pencil skirt is actually a straight cut but fitted skirt. It didn't necessarily have the waspy waist. A lot of women would then put a belt, either a vinyl or a leather or even an elasticized belt around their waist that would create the waspy waist. And a pencil skirt could cut off either at the knee, just below, or come to mid-calf, and would often have a slit at the back to help with that restricted movement. Or sometimes there was even pleating in the back of the skirt, or it might go all the way around and become a fishtail or a mermaid skirt. Then the sheath skirt that I mentioned a little bit earlier, and you'll often see in the form of a dress as well, known as the sheath dress. This kind of skirt is that bit longer, comes down to the mid-calf, and has the waspy waist with the hips that jut out, creating that really authentic 50s wasp shape. It is literally built into the skirt. These often have pockets that jut out to the side, again creating that accentuated hip shape. For women that didn't have big hips, they didn't have to worry about wearing like padding under their clothing because this created the hips for them because the dress or the skirt is quite structured. The other thing that's referred to a lot in 1950s clothing is the poodle skirt. Now, what exactly is the poodle skirt? It is not an all-round kind of term representing the circle skirt. Actually, the poodle skirt was named because originally the design had a poodle on the hemline, like literally an embroidered poodle. But this also refers to any skirt that has that kind of emblem hanging over the hemline. So there's a picture here where the girl has a dog or an Eiffel Tower or a cat, but they were still referred to as the poodle skirt because that was kind of the all-round reference term for that type of skirt. The other thing that was very popular that I know many of you have referred to in the Vintage Tips and Tricks Facebook group is the house dress. Now, the house dress was very popular during this era because men had come back from the war. There was this big kind of social push for people to move out to the suburbs and to live the happy family life and the American dream. In particular, this idea of the happy family definitely came from American advertising. Think Mad Men and the advertising men of Madison Avenue. This idea was really pushed that it was the woman's role to create the happy family.
Cook the meals, do the dishes, make the beds, dust the house.
To always be beautiful, to wake up before her husband, make sure her hair and makeup was done. And even her house dress had to be beautiful so that she could do her housework and be comfortable, but she could also pop down the street for a coffee or go to the shops and look beautiful if she put some accessories on, grabbed a handbag and put her gloves on. So the house dress often had a circle skirt or some sort of gathered skirt, but it didn't have as much material as a full skirt did because it was too restrictive. There was too much material that would get in her way if she was like scrubbing and cleaning. So it had to be kind of a functional dress. Often they had buttoning down the top, which was then called the shirt dress. Usually women would only wear a single petticoat underneath, and it would have pretty unrestricted sleeves. Often it was a cap sleeve that was rolled up, which kind of became a really famous look and was seen on Audrey Hepburn in Roman Holiday. She had a beautiful white shirt on with the capped rolled sleeves. These dresses also had mid-length sleeves and three-quarter sleeves, but they never went any longer than that because a woman wouldn't want to get her sleeves dirty or wet whilst doing housework, would she? That's not very ladylike. Other tops that were popular were the peasant top, as many of us know, and that came in many, many different forms. From a singlety style that you could then pop off your shoulders, right through to things that came right up to your neckline, little crop tops, and stuff that had more of a Latino and Mexican inspired feel to it with raffia edging and things like that. Again, you can get it from Vivian Holloway. I really kind of think that she is the supreme supplier for stuff from this era. She's really nailed it. There was also things like slash neck tops, batwing tops. There was lots of little kind of sweater girl tops. This was the era of the sweater girl, very much like this style. So you've got your pointy bullet bra underneath, you've got a batwing top like I've got on now, and then you had kind of gathered detail. There was a lot of different design patterns. A lot of tops had like V kind of styling here, or were two-tone, or had different colored edging than they did to the main material of the top, and they were all cropped so that they met the waistline of your skirt or your pants to give you, again, that waspy look. Tops were made in knitted material, in terry toweling material. There was a huge range of stuff. Of course, knits were still very popular, cardigans were still popular. The twin set. Who hasn't seen the matching little cropped sweater with a matching cardigan and then a little sweater clip holding your cardigan open if you just wanted to wear your cardigan on your shoulders? Then of course your cardigan had to match your nails and possibly even your shoes and maybe even your handbag. It was the era of matchy matchy after all. In terms of outerwear, jackets had a very boxy feel to them. They were looser fitting to go over the top of your waspy, close fitting main garments. So there were box style jackets that led into the 1960s. You had kind of big open hanging jackets with a batwing sleeve with wide lapels that often came right down to the hemline. A hemline would sit like mid thigh and would often sit open and wouldn't be closed so that you could see the shape of your garments underneath. Some of the jackets even came mid calf, but again had that big kind of batwing loose fitting feel so that you could see the shape of your clothes underneath, or so you could reveal what you were wearing. But also, very important, if you were wearing the ever popular full skirt with all your petticoats, your coat had to be large enough that it fitted over the top of all of that bulk. Now, during this era, hats were still popular, as were fascinators, but throughout the decade and toward the end of the decade, they became less and less popular because there were more and more hairstyles. The makeup artist and the hairstylist became bigger and more important, largely due to Hollywood. People like Max Factor were really on the rise. Their role was really important in Hollywood, and they had started to push their products out into the mainstream. So women really, really started wearing makeup and getting their hair done regularly at the hairdresser in sets that they would then sleep in throughout the week. So they would carry their hairspray and their makeup out and about with them to touch up because they always had to look perfect. Therefore, bags were a little bit bigger and people weren't wearing hats so much because their hair was too big and their hair was too important to be detracted from by a hat. So the hat either had to work with the hair, which is why you'll see a lot of kind of fascinator styles or the hats that sat to the back of the head and were much smaller and more ornamental rather than being functional like they had in previous eras. Women also incorporated hair flowers, clips, and other ornamental accessories that brought attention to their hair. The other thing that became popular are things like a rain bonnet, so like a plastic bonnet that would protect your hair, which you can still get now. I think it is just called the bonnet. And then women would wear silk scarves on their hair to protect their hairdo because they spent a lot of money going to the hairdresser every week, getting their hair professionally done so it looked perfect. And then they would sleep upright on pillows so they didn't ruin their hairstyle. Of course, you had to have money for that. Some people literally did their hair every day, but it was very time consuming. Spending that extra bit of money on the way they looked was something that they incorporated into their budget. And things like hair nets and silk scarves became very important in maintaining that look overnight and when they went outside into the elements. Gloves were still very popular. Silk scarves were very popular during this time and were even incorporated into outfits in ways that we probably wouldn't think of now. A lot of women would drape a longer, bigger silk scarf around their front, sort of in the style that my top is, but then the scarf would be clipped underneath their belt and then come out and fan out at the bottom. Many jackets were pleated, but if you didn't have a pleated jacket, women would actually create this look with a scarf, which was very popular and commonly appeared in Parisian Vogue. Ever so stylish. Seam stockings were still all the rage, although they were no longer a fully fashion stocking, or I think they were at the start of the era, and then they worked their way into a full nylon stocking toward the end of the era in different colors. They had different patterns, so you could get all sorts of different heels that you guys might be familiar with that are still available today, particularly here in the UK, and you can get them shipped overseas, probably for a little bit of money, but they last forever. So if you're wondering, it is definitely worth purchasing them because unlike a pair of contemporary stockings that will get a run in them like the second time you wear them, every fashioned or nylon original seams pair of stockings that I've ever bought, whether they're reproduction or real originals, has never gotten a run in it. And I wear them a lot, so investing in that and a proper suspender belt is really well worth the money and you will look incredibly authentic. And I think finally we've come to shoes. So we all know that supremely popular in the 1950s was, of course, the pump in a multitude of colours. They even had shoe protectors that slipped over the top of your pump so that only the heel was exposed, and they clipped underneath the arch of the foot so that you could walk around and kind of still look like you were wearing pumps, but actually you were wearing like rain boot pumps, and then you took them off when you arrived at your destination. They also used to wear very strappy sandal style high heels or kitten heel shoes, very popular with Marilyn Monroe. Wedges were very popular, and there was a lot of flat shoes that were still very popular. We of course have seen Audrey Hepburn in a multitude of shoes, from ballet flats right through to penny loafers and moccasins. If you are a lover of Jane Mansfield and Marilyn Monroe like me, of course you will know the mules and the springaladers that became incredibly popular during this era, as did the tropical inspired ones, where island shoes were getting shipped over to the States, and there were actually beautiful wooden heels or wedges or that kind of mule shape with carved heels in them. So they became really, really popular, especially with the likes of Carmen Miranda sporting them, and tiki was of course all the rage. Women still wore saddle shoes, they still wore functional shoes, and again, shoes that are still easily available today in the flat shoe section of just about any shoe store you go to, even really, really cheap stores like Target, Kmart, and Primark. And ballet flats even had little ribbons on them, so you could get standard ballet flats like you did today, or you could get ballet flats that had ribbons much like point shoes, which were inspired by some of the Hollywood stars, especially people like Audrey Hepburn that went from being ballerinas through to movie stars and would often appear in those kind of shoes in films. It did cross over into everyday life, and because people were watching television and going to the cinema, which was a very popular post-war pastime, these styles really heavily influenced everyday outfits worn by women in the 1950s. And again, because women were aspiring to have that kind of perfect look, they really aspired to look like the women of the movies. And people like Max Factor, who were famous makeup artists and hair artists of Hollywood, were also promoting their products to the everyday woman. And so they were promoted as being achievable for the everyday woman. I think I'm gonna leave it there, guys. There's a ton of information. I'm gonna leave some links down below that you can check out, because there's lots of reproduction stuff from the 1950s that you can get your hands on. There is a ton of original stuff on eBay and on Etsy. And there are a lot of vintage stores that you can find easily on Instagram that sell all this kind of stuff as well. If you like this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and click that little notification bell so you know when my videos come out. Come and join the Vintage Tips and Tricks Facebook community. Follow me on Instagram and Twitter, and I will see you in my next video. Thanks for watching, guys. Bye.